try to be, well, I will be brief this morning. This is something that kind of been going on, and I've been feeling this way for a bit. I want to read Psalms 46. It says, God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear though the earth gives way, though the mountains be moved into the heart of the sea, though its waters roam and roar and foam, though the mountains tremble at its swelling. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy habitation of the Most High. God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. God will help her when morning dawns. The nations rage, the kingdoms totter. He utters his voice, the earth melts. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Come, behold the works of the Lord, how he has brought desolations on the earth. He makes wars cease to the end of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns the chariots with fire. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. As I was reading this psalm, I started thinking, how does this apply to me? And this is what came to my mind. It says here in verse 1, the Lord is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. And then in verse 11, it says, the God of Jacob is our fortress. So I started thinking, he's our refuge, he's our fortress, he's calling us in. And when we are inside, we're protected from everything.
Amen.
But lately for me, I feel like I am inside, but I am at the doorway looking out. And it's raining, and I'm getting wet. And he keeps telling me, just come inside because you're getting wet. And for some reason, I feel like I'm not as connected as I want to be, and I'm not hearing as much as I want to hear. There's a lot of distraction going on, and I'm trying to get away from that and figure out what those distractions are. And it's been very difficult because I feel like at this moment I'm just standing somewhere so I don't lose my direction, but there's a lot of fog in front of me that I'm trying to get rid of. So the point that I'm trying to make is this. Don't just stand in the doorway when he's telling you come in, because inside is where you're going to be protected. And if you feel like you're lost, just go back, because he's our compass. He gives us the direction and shows us the path where we are supposed to walk.
Amen.
I know that this fog that is in front of me right now is going to go away, and I'll have a clear vision of the path that I'm supposed to continue to be walking on. And I pray that it happens really soon so that I can continue moving forward instead of just standing still.
Amen.
That's it.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Thank you,
Lord.
Any prayer requests or testimonies this morning? It's a beautiful day outside.
Amen.
Just pass it.
Prayer for Sally, for healing.
We'll lift her up. Let's pray for all of those that are not here because either they're traveling or they're unable to be here for whatever reason, that the Lord continues to touch them, and those that are out with their families, that he keeps them safe, and those that are going through something, that they're delivered.
Services and I just thank God for them. You know, they both came back to Afghanistan and raised the families, and my brothers and
children in this neighborhood and the families. Yesterday I was in here getting prepared and working on some other things around the complex here. And it seems like every time I get in here and spend some time with the Lord stuff, all of a sudden I hear a bunch of kids playing on the stoop. So I went out and talked to them after I was done hearing stuff and invited them here at 10 o'clock for Sunday school and stuff like that. So reaching out to them, talk to them, start to form some kind of, it's okay, you know, to talk to them situation. And,
yeah.
And also next door, Cassie and her kids, just keep them lifted up. Just lead them to the Lord. And just pray for the Spirit to touch her and her home and family. Watch over them also.
Amen.
Amen.
Anyone else?
Hallelujah.
Okay, well, let's stand in the morning. Let's come to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you this morning for bringing us here in your presence. We thank you, Lord, because you are the light of our lives. You, Lord, light up the path that we are supposed to walk. And you, Lord, give us wisdom. Give us revelation. You clear any obstacles that are in front of us that are preventing us from seeing the path that you want us to walk in. We pray, Father, for all of our service members. We ask that you continue to lift them up, keep them safe and protected, and bring them back home safe. We thank you for all of those that are no longer with us, but they are in your glory, spending their eternal days with you. We thank you, Father, for all of your promises, for all of your blessings. You have declared us righteous. You have declared us prosperous. So we ask, Lord, that all of those that are in need of healing right now, your hand touches them and the manifestation of your healing takes place, Lord, because we know that you have said that we are healed. Those that are lost, Father, that are looking for you, that they listen to the call of your Spirit and they're able to hear your voice so they can come and go in the direction that you want them to go. They can meet the people that you want them to meet for them to know who you are on this earth, Father. We thank you, Lord, because you're always with us. You keep us safe and protected. You are a faithful Lord, that your word always comes to pass. Everything you say that you will do, you do. Thank you, Father, for bringing us here this morning so that we can hear your word, we can worship you. And thank you, Lord, spend this time together as a church, as one body. Worship you, Lord. Giving you thanks and giving you all the praise, honor, and glory. Thank you, Lord. It's all about you. In Jesus' name. Please turn your phone off.
Picked it up.
It's not working. It's stuck. Alright, so tomorrow, Memorial Day, those that are gone but they're not forgotten, thank you, Lord, for our service members and for everything they have done and day, and for putting their lives on the line so we can have the freedom that we have. And then this Friday, June 10th, no, next Friday.
It's tentative.
Tentative?
Depending on the weather. Changed the funds yesterday, couldn't save it apparently. Eastern Gate House of Prayer, I'll be out there through that week or part of that week, and instead of having House of Prayer here, we'll have it there. That's tentative. As it gets closer and the pinwheel at our local weather stations tell us where it's going to stop, if it's going to rain or be nice, we'll depend on it. We meet out there at 7 o'clock. We'll have a time of fellowship before and afterwards, so just giving a heads up.
Praise the Lord.
Yeah.
prayer unplugged, is what we'll call it. All right, let's speak the word this morning. Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you? I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons. I speak in new tongues. I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function. And I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of Him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened, and I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of His servant, and Abraham's blessings are mine.
Hallelujah.
Eric, could you take the offering, please? Thank you.
Father, we are so blessed and thankful for this day. Lord, we thank you so much for the precious gifts that you freely offer us, love, grace, mercy, and salvation.
Thank you.
We pray that you guide and lead us, that we walk in faith and not sight, Lord. Pray that you bless this offering and that it's added to your abundant riches. In Jesus' mighty name, amen.
Amen. Amen.
Pray for Myron and his guitar playing. We're planting seeds, and he's rehearsing with us.
Thank the Lord.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let's start learning guitar. All right, me. Glory. Glory. I can hear the sound. Hallelujah. 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 Well, with the ladies gone, we've kind of leaned to the other side. I had to get Miriam off the platform, and at the last minute, this is the last thing I could think of. But that's okay. God bless them, and even with Rick showing up, there'll be a twang in our worship that you probably haven't heard before here. Sure, could use Mr. McBride on his harmonica, but that's okay. Hallelujah. You ready, James?
The Lord's loving kindnesses indeed will never cease. Every day. they are new every morning.
I can hear the tambourine.
They are new every day. Oh, great is thy faithfulness. Oh, us every day.
Thank you, Jamie.
And his great mercies, they'll never fade away.
They are new
every morning.
They are new.
Before you, and the eyes of all men will be fixed on the Lamb who was crucified. For with wisdom and mercy and justice you reign at your Father's side, and the angels will cry, Hail to the Lamb who was slain for the ruling power, and the earth will reply, You shall reign as the King of all kings and the Lord of all lords.
With a shield
in our hand and a sword at our side. There's a fire in our spirits that cannot be denied. As the Father has told us, for these you have died. For the nations that gathered before you. And the ears of all men need to hear of the Lamb who was crucified. He was ascended from heaven, yet was raised up to reign at your Father's side, and the angels will cry, Hail to the Lamb who was slain for the world, ruling power.
King of all kings and the Lord of all. As the King of all kings and the Lord of all.
Just like your presence was in here yesterday, Lord. Reign, Lord. Reign, Lord, in this place. Reign in this place, oh Lord. Lift up the heavy hearts, Lord. Lift up the heavy hearts, Lord. You are our hope.
Falling in love with you.
Come on, church.
Oh, I
There's nothing like your presence, Lord. Nothing like your presence, Lord. There's healing in your wings. There's healing in your wings. There's healing in this room, Lord. You promised that where two or three are gathered, Lord, there you are also. Claim your healing, church. Claim your healing, church. Let it wash over you. Call on the name of the Lord, church. Come on. Call on his name, church. You alone are holy, Lord. Cause you alone are holy, Lord. You alone are holy, Lord. You are worthy, Lord. Worthy, Lord. You're worthy. just gave me a Lord. The Lord just gave me a word. In that fog, reach out your hand and you will touch his hand. Trust in him. Sometimes we try to look at our own eyes. Put on your spirit eyes and you will reach out into that fog and you will see. And you will see and you will feel his hand touching your hand. And he will lead you on as you worship him.
Thank you, Jesus. We love you this morning. Thank you, Lord, for being our rock, our place of refuge, and ever-present help in the time of trouble. Lord, our confidence is in you. And we know, Lord, that our faith is simply a response to your finished work. It's not something we create or that we develop. It's just believing and what you have already done. Thank you, Jesus, for healing our bodies.
Yes, Lord.
For protecting us, for providing for us, for directing our paths, and for always being with us, Lord. We bless your name this morning, Lord. We celebrate the victory over every attack of the enemy, over every lie of the devil. Your word is sure and true. And we declare it to be our reality in Jesus' name. And everybody said, praise the Lord.
Praise
Amen.
The Lord.
God bless you. You may be seated.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, worship team, the all-male testosterone group here. Just working overtime. Hallelujah. I feel hair growing on my back right now. Praise the Lord. Just stand back. Praise God. Thank the Lord. Amen. If the Sunday school kids haven't already left, they certainly may now. I want to talk to you a little bit this morning. I'm gonna be relatively brief. I've got a funeral we have to go to after church, and so I want to be obedient to the Lord. But it's a family thing, so praise the Lord. Not often that you have funerals on Sundays anymore, so it kind of surprised me that they had it today, but nevertheless, that's the reality that we're dealing with, amen? So I want to talk to you about some parallels, some contrasts this morning, and hopefully it'll help us to kind of settle in to what the Lord has done and what the Lord has promised us. Now, I know a lot of times facts don't agree with the truth, and we have people today, including my wife, that are dealing with physical issues, and but that doesn't change what the Word of God says. It doesn't change the truth of God's Word. Sometimes facts have to be aligned to the truth. You know, how many of you know that the facts that we knew a couple hundred years ago are not the truth that we know today? They were facts at the time, But over time, the truth prevails, and now we have truth that basically flies in the face of what was fact just a matter of years ago. And so that's the reality that we deal with. We have to settle in on the truth of God's word and hold fast to that no matter what. No matter what whatever the symptoms are, whatever the situations or circumstances that we might be dealing with, the word of God is still true. And the only means by which these circumstances or facts can be changed. Amen? So that is what I want to talk to you about. And I'm going to go back in time a little bit because I got a lot of that behind me. Praise the Lord. It's easy to go back. Amen. But I've just been thinking about some things over the last several days. And, you know, for one thing, you know that you're old. If you can remember when bacon, eggs, sunshine were good for you. Praise the Lord. Amen. I'm still struggling with trying to change that mindset. Praise the Lord. I still like bacon. I still like eggs. And I'm still in the sun all the time. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
But I've got a couple acres of ground plus here at the church to mow. And so either in the sun or you're doing it in the rain, one of the two. So you don't have a whole lot of options. Praise the Lord. But that's a good thing. Hallelujah. I'm glad I can still do it. Just continue to do it. If the Lord takes me or he shows up, then I won't have to mow anymore. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. All right, let's go to Exodus chapter 31, and we'll begin with Exodus 31, verse 15. Six days may work be done, but in the seventh is the Sabbath of rest. Everybody say Sabbath of rest.
Sabbath.
That was almost all of you. Praise the Lord. Sabbath of rest. Holy to the Lord. Whosoever doeth any work in the Sabbath day, he shall surely be put to death. Praise the Lord. This was serious business. Amen.
Amen.
All right. Let's go to Luke now, chapter 6, and we'll read verses 1 through 5. Luke 6, 1 through 5. And it came to pass on the second Sabbath after the first that he went through the cornfields, and his disciples plucked the ears of corn and did eat, rubbing them in their hands. And certain of the Pharisees said unto them, Why do ye that which is not lawful to do on the Sabbath days? And Jesus answering them said, Have ye not read so much as this, what David did when he himself was hungered, and they which were with him? How he went into the house of God and did take and eat the shewbread, and gave also to them that were with him, which it is not lawful to eat, but for the priests alone. And he said unto them that the Son of Man is Lord also of the Sabbath. Praise the Lord. So, you know, when I was a kid, and I'm talking about, you know, pre-double digits, back when I was like 6, 7, 8, 9, back in that area, They still had blue laws. In fact, I think until in my early teen years, throughout the 50s, they still had what they called blue laws, which was that nothing was basically open on Sunday. Certainly, you couldn't buy liquor. The bars were not open. But most businesses even were closed, with the exception maybe of a gas station here or there, like the one that I had to work in when I got a little older. But when I was a little kid, my earliest memories of the Sabbath was shaped by Sunday. And you say, well, aren't they the same? Well, that's part of what we're going to talk about this morning. But it was a day that was filled with equal measures of boredom and dread. I know this is going to be exciting for you. Praise the Lord. Now, I'm talking about when I was a little kid. You know, 8, 9, 10 years old. Now, we didn't call Sunday the Sabbath at our house. When I was growing up, that isn't a word that was used. Now, we went to church, but not every Sunday. So some Sundays we'd go, some Sundays we didn't go. Sunday was a day off. But even though Sunday came with Saturday, you know, the weekend, it was really easy to tell the difference between the two. they weren't the same. Even though they were part of the same weekend, Sunday wasn't like Saturday, even as a kid. Sunday was Saturday's sober companion. On Sunday, everything seemed different. The television we watched, the food that we ate, even the way we played, everything was changed by the nature of the day. This is the way the world was. It's the way it was in the small town that I grew up in, but I think it was pretty much that way everywhere. Outside, the street was deserted. The friends that I'd played with the day before were nowhere to be found. Not that I was allowed to be out running in the street, but you know, you're looking around and you're thinking, man, what we were doing yesterday, playing ball, you know, climbing trees, whatever it was we were doing, nobody's around to be doing any of that now. We were either squirming in discomfort on the pews of the church down the street, or we were at a relative's eating off the Sunday china. Everything was different on Sunday. The normal food that we ate during the week was replaced with the kind of food that took hours to cook. And it filled the house with all kinds of smells that weren't there during the normal week. On Saturday nights, my folks would, sometimes they'd go out or they'd have some friends over. And but back in those days, kids were seen and not heard. That was literal. We were sent either upstairs or to the basement, or if it was in nice weather outside. We didn't hang out with the older people, praise the Lord. We got out of the way so we couldn't embarrass them, I think, more than anything else. But most Saturday nights were spent in front of the TV. TV was a big deal back then in the 50s, and there were, although there was only a few shows to watch, it was still a fascination, you know. And so that's what typically our Saturday evenings would be filled with. And then Sunday was a day that we were off, not going to school, not doing other things that we would normally be doing like Saturday, but there wasn't the same kind of enthusiasm. Praise the Lord. Chronologically, Sunday may have been the first day of the week, but to me, Sunday was the collapse of the weekend. Praise the Lord. I'm just being honest, hallelujah. It was kind of a downer. It was different. It wasn't as exciting and fun and, you know, we looking forward to and so forth. The truth is that most people think of Sunday as part of the weekend. The first day of the week is just a day off. And for some people today, it's not even that, because we have people that have to work on Sunday. All the businesses and everything are still operating on Sundays, and so you still got to go to work. Amen? And those who still have the luxury of treating Sunday as a day of rest don't usually do much resting. Praise the Lord. Our idea of rest has gotten confused with play and activity. Then you go back to work on Monday, and I remember when I was working secular jobs, come back to work on Monday and everybody's dragging around saying, man, I needed one more day to get through this weekend. I mean, I'm just not ready to get back to this grind again, you know. So we spent all of our energy on the weekend when we should have been resting, amen, and come back to work on Monday more exhausted than we were on Friday when we left. Amen. But if very few Christians today treat Sunday as the Sabbath. And I mean in the context of what we're talking about. There are some who are still very rigid and strict in these things, but not very many. But even Christmas and Easter are better defined as holidays than holy days. That's just a reality. So we look at things differently. Let's look at Colossians, Sheila, Colossians chapter 2 and verse 16. Not to get you on a guilt trip here, I want to stay faithful to what the Word of God is saying. So Colossians 2:16, Paul is dealing with this very issue. Remember, he's talking to people who understood all these Sabbath laws and had lived under them for years. So let no man therefore judge you in meat or in drink or in respect of a holy day or of a new moon or the Sabbath days. So I'm not trying to put you on a guilt trip. I'm just making some comparisons here. All of that Paul is referring to was associated with the law of Moses. The first day worship was the result of the resurrection of Christ. Amen? First day of the week became the Lord's day. We're on the first day of the week. This isn't actually the end of the weekend. This is the first day, amen, of the week. And as Christians, we refer to it as the Lord's day. The day of the week happens to be Sunday, but it's still the Lord's day. Amen? Let's look at this in Revelation chapter 1 and verse 10. So there was a shift that came from the Saturday Sabbath to the Sunday, first day of the week. Now, John is exiled to the Isle of Patmos, and he says, I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day. First day, resurrection day, first day of the week, amen? And heard behind me a great voice as of a trumpet. So he says, this is the Lord's day, amen? And the Lord's day was never meant to be burdened with the kind of limitations that were typical of the Hebrew Sabbath, where every bit of work, all work was forbidden. You couldn't even go out when the time in the wilderness, they couldn't even gather manna on the Sabbath. That was considered work. Amen? So it was illegal. So in the law, the weekly observance of the Sabbath was to remind Israel of their deliverance from slavery. Amen? Under the law, the observance of the Sabbath was to constantly keep Israel in mind that they were no longer slaves, that God had set them free, that they had been delivered, amen, from slavery. Now, looking back at it today, it actually, from our culture, it looks like the opposite. It looks like they just exchanged one type of slavery for another. Look at Numbers chapter 15, verses 32 through 36. Now, we read these things and it sounds like we're dealing with two different gods. It's like a contradiction of some kind. But that's my point. I'm trying to show you not only the contrast, but the parallels as well. Amen? So Numbers 15, verse 32 through 36. While the children of Israel were in the wilderness, they found a man that gathered sticks on the Sabbath day. And they that found him gathering sticks brought him unto Moses and Aaron and unto all the congregation. And they put him in ward, or they locked him up, because it was not declared what should be done to him. And the Lord said unto Moses, the man shall be surely put to death. All the congregation shall stone him with stones without the camp. And all the congregation brought him without the camp and stoned him with stones, and he died, as the Lord commanded Moses. Now, that's a little bit stronger even than God saying, go to your room. You know, you've been bad, amen? He's saying, basically, what he's saying here is rest or I'll kill you. Amen. Rest was important. You either rest or you die. You get a dirt nap. Praise the Lord. If you won't take a regular rest, you'll get the long one. Amen. But here's the deal. It was more than a spiritual practice. It was mainly a sign of the covenant, and that's why it was so critically important that they kept this. Amen. Exodus chapter 31 and verse 17. Now we know that everything back there was meant for us as well as for them. Not that we are to keep the law, but we got to learn something from it. Otherwise, it just becomes confusing. Amen. So it's a sign between me and the children of Israel forever. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, and on the seventh day he rested and was refreshed. So the Sabbath day was a constant, continuous reminder of God's covenant with Israel. Amen? Now, here's interesting. I'm not going to go to all these scriptures because we don't have time, but you can look them up for yourself. Every 7 years under the law was a Sabbath year, and the lands would all lie fallow. There wasn't any work being done in the fields. All debts were canceled every seventh year. That was a seventh-year Sabbath. Then every 50 years, there was this extreme Sabbath, and I do mean extreme. It was called the Year of Jubilee. And the fields were left unplanted. The vineyards were unattended. It was extreme. Amen. Sabbath year. Indentured servants were set free. People that had been taken into servitude because they couldn't pay a debt, because they owed somebody, they could take them and make them work off their debt. Regardless of how much debt they still owed, on that Jubilee year, they were set free. They were released from their servitude. Amen. Any family members or property that had been taken into someone else's possession because of debt had to be released back to the original owner. It had to go back to the people. In other words, you owe me a bunch of money, I'm going to take that field because you can't pay your debt. So I'm taking this field as payment for that. At the 50th year, on the year of Jubilee, that land had to go back to whoever it belonged to originally, even if the debt was still there. So everything reverted back to original owners. The biblical observance of Sabbath, that was an obligation under the law. It was a responsibility and an obligation that you had to keep. But listen, the Lord of the Sabbath has come. Jesus told us that in Luke. Everything's changed. Now, Israel looked forward to the promise that was going to come. They kept the Sabbath because they were looking forward to the fulfillment of these Sabbath laws. For us as Christians, we look back to the promise that's been fulfilled, the promise that has been kept. Look at Colossians again, chapter 2, verses 16 and 17. You know, we have church services on Friday. We have church services on Wednesday. I'm talking about within Christianity. Saturday nights, a lot of churches have service on Saturday nights. So it's not a question of a day. Let no man, therefore, judge you in meat or in drink or in respect of a holy day or the new moon or the Sabbath days, which are a shadow of things to come. But the body is Christ. In other words, all of those things were just vague kind of images. They were shadows. But the reality, the flesh and blood, the purpose of all those things is Christ. They were just types. They were something pointing us to a greater reality. And that's Jesus. And maybe that's why eventually the first day replaced the seventh day in the church. Because of the resurrection. That's the day that Jesus was resurrected. Amen? The Sabbath foreshadowed the Lord's day. Praise God. The aim of all this is to create an atmosphere. All that we saw under the old covenant and all that we have in the new covenant, all of it was for a purpose. And that purpose was to create an atmosphere that allows space for our own awareness of God. It made them think about God. They thought about the provision. They thought about the deliverance. They thought on that day they did nothing else. That's what they did. They just thought about that. It made God more real in a way. And that's what all of this points us to Jesus, is so that we could create an atmosphere in our own lives. Not just on Sunday, but we could create an atmosphere. We are now the temple of God. And we have the Lord of the Sabbath living in us. But I got to tell you, we go through a lot of our time without even a consciousness of God, without being aware of God. And I'm just speaking from in general terms that people that are Christians, it's like, you know, here's my life and here's Sunday. Here's what I am, but here's what I am on Sunday. And I'm saying that all of this is to bring us to a place where we are God conscious all the time. And I'm not talking about being flaky, weird, you know, fall down on your face religious in that sense. I'm just saying conscious. Conscious that God has delivered me. Conscious that God has healed me. Conscious that God has provided for me. Conscious. God conscious. That's what he's trying to direct us to. That's the purpose amen, for all of these Sabbath laws and rituals was to point us to a promise fulfilled. That He is our healer. That He is our deliverer. That He is our provision. Matthew chapter 6, verse 30 and 31. That's why, you know, there are some organizations that celebrate Saturday worship, and they're just fanatic about it. And that's their privilege to do whatever they want to. But, I mean, the Scripture itself tells us, you know, don't be judging people by what day. It's not about the day. It's about whether God is known on any day. It's whether we are aware, God conscious. Wherefore, if God so clothed the grass of the field, which today is, and tomorrow is cast into the oven, shall He not much more clothe you, O ye of little faith? Therefore, take no thought, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or wherewithal shall we be clothed? God is always present with us. But it's our preoccupation with necessities, with circumstances of life, that distract us from Him. We were talking about distraction a few minutes ago. Roberto, what distracts us? Stuff. Life. Needs. Lack. Confrontation. Circumstances. Rest is more than a spiritual discipline. And the Sabbath is more than a day. And that's my point. In the law, the Sabbath was a concrete expression of God's rule over His people. Amen. By that, they experienced His provision for them. By keeping the Sabbath, the people of Israel were reminded that they were dependent on God and connected with each other. That's why the Scripture talks about forsaking not the assembling of yourselves together as the manner of some is. Because we need the commonality of our faith to keep us focused on God instead of getting sucked off into all the other circumstances and situations and issues of life. Because they are there.
Yes. Yes.
Praise the Lord. The Sabbath pointed to the rest of God. Not the rest of God, but the rest of God. Amen?
Amen.
It's a gift from God. Now, under the law, it was a command. Under Christ, it's a blessing. It's a reward. It's a gift. It's what we believers would later come to know as the kingdom. We talk a lot about the kingdom. The kingdom come, thy kingdom come, thy will be done. Let's get the kingdom. Let's seek the kingdom. He's given us the kingdom. It's the rest of God. It's the resting in Him. It's the trusting Him. It's the confidence in Him providing for us. It's the confidence of Him being our healer, being our deliverer, being our protector, our provision. The Sabbath laws were a constant reminder to Israel of their weak faith, of their inability to trust God. And let me just give you a quick look at this. In Leviticus chapter 25, verse 20, there's a question asked. It's asked of the people of Israel. And it's, I got to tell you, I think we ask the same question, just in a little different verbiage. Ye shall say, what shall we eat the seventh year? In other words, when we're not working, what are we going to be eating? The year that we don't plant, Right? The year that we don't harvest, the year that we don't tend any of the fields, how are we going to eat then? They're asking God, what will we eat the seventh year? Behold, we shall not sow nor gather in our increase. We can't go out and reap anything that's in the field. We can't sow anything into the field. What are we supposed to be eating then? And I'm saying that's the mindset that we have many times. If I trust God, what am I going to eat? If I'm just trusting Him, where's my clothes coming from? If I'm just going to trust Him, how am I going to get healed? How am I going to get delivered? If I'm resting in you, I'm not doing anything anymore, where's my benefit going to come from? Here's the answer, verse 21 and 22. And this is pointing to Jesus. Then I'll command my blessing upon you in the sixth year. And it'll bring forth fruit for 3 years. And you'll sow the eighth year, that's the year after, and eat, and you'll still be eating of the fruit until the ninth year. Because you won't be able to harvest in the eighth year because you'll be sowing, right? Until her fruits come in, ye shall eat of the old store. In other words, I'm going to make sure that there's an abundance so that when you rest in me, you're going to get 3 years out of what you normally get one. In other words, I'm going to do exceeding abundantly above all that you can ask or think. This is not just theology. This is the Word of God trying to show us that this has been His plan from the very beginning. That we would rest, and that rest would cause us to look to Him and to trust in Him instead of our own strength, instead of our own ability, because every one of us are going to come to the end of those things at some point in our life, sometimes several times. Either physically you just can't do it, or you lose your job, or your finances get turned upside down, or there's some other issue or whatever. And then we go, oh, Lord, what am I going to do? How about you rest? How about you trust that I'm your provider? That I will make a way where there seems to be no way. Praise the Lord. That answer is the foreshadow of Jesus Christ Himself. I'll be your reward. Amen. I'll supply your every need. Come unto me, all you that labor and heavy laden. I'll give you rest. I'll bless you coming in. I'll bless you going out. I'll bless you in the storehouse. I'll bless you in the field. You'll be the head and not the tail, above and not beneath, the lender and not the borrower. Praise the Lord. Okay, back to Matthew again, 6, verse 31 through 33. Matthew 6, 31 through 33. Therefore, take no thought saying, what shall we eat or what shall we drink? You see where Jesus is coming from now? Mm-hmm. He's talking to people that have been dealing with this law all of their lives, and he's trying to get them to understand what that was all about. Take no thought saying, what shall we eat or what shall we drink or wherewithal shall we be clothed? For after all these things do the Gentiles seek, the unbelievers. For your heavenly Father knoweth that ye have need of all these things. But seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things shall be added to you. See, it's an invitation to rest. That's what Jesus is saying. The kingdom isn't something of our making. It isn't something we create. And the lesson is neither are the things that we come to and buy or think that we come to or come by our own hands. Amen? You think, well, I got a job. I'm working 40 hours a week. I'm working 45. I'm working 48. I'm working whatever. Listen, don't kid yourself that your stuff is coming by your ability or by your hand. If God has declared us, covered us with his righteousness, will he not also cover our bodies with clothes? If he has declared us righteous from the inside out, would he not fill our bellies with food if we need it? To seek first the kingdom means that we will rest. Because to seek the kingdom is to trust God for those things. It isn't the opposite. It isn't like we kind of get the kingdom and then we get the stuff. It's seeking the kingdom itself is declaring our trust. We're seeking rest. We're seeking him, the Lord of the Sabbath. Luke chapter 12, verse 32. In other words, seeking him isn't like we're scrounging around somewhere. We're just conscious. We're aware. He is my source. He's my provision. He's my healer. He's my deliverer. He's my savior. Fear not, little flock, for it's your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. You don't earn the kingdom. You receive a kingdom. Praise God. We enter into the state of rest by turning from our effort and rely on the finished work of Christ. That's how simple it is. We've made it a full-time job trying to get the kingdom when he gives us the kingdom. And we just rely on the finished work of Jesus and experience it. So, you know, to really understand the Bible idea of rest, you have to look past the Sabbath day. You have to look past the Sabbath disciplines. Because both of them are pointing to something else. Mark chapter 2, verse 27 and 28. And he said unto them, the Sabbath was made for man, and not man for the Sabbath. Therefore, the Son of Man is Lord also of the Sabbath. So, Israel had this idea that man was made for the Sabbath, to make it something or to respond to it. When in fact, Jesus says, the Sabbath was made for you. So you could rest in what God has done. So you could have confidence that God will take care of you, that God will supply your needs, that God will be not only your Savior, but your provider. See, God's presence isn't a function of a particular worship style or ministry method. God's presence is our birthright. Can you say amen?
Amen.
His presence is our birthright.
Thank you, Lord.
We've been born from above. That's why it's not how we worship. We all worship in different ways because we have different personalities. We have a different kind of interaction with God, you know? So it isn't one way versus another. It isn't one type of ministry. We'll say, well, he's evangelistic, or he's a teacher, or this one is he's more of a preacher. I don't know what any of that means. It's just, you just are what you are, right? I'm not saying anyone is right or anyone is wrong. I'm just saying whatever we are, God, that's what God uses. So it's not the method, it's the God. The command to observe the Sabbath was both a sign and an invitation to enter into the experience of God. Praise God. But because Jesus has come to be our Sabbath, we can experience God every day, in every situation, under all circumstances, anywhere. But the Sabbath reminds us to be conscious, to be aware, to be, you know, sensitive to the fact that God is working. See, the pursuit of rest is actually the pursuit of God. They are one and the same. That's what he's telling us. Seek first the kingdom of God, his righteousness, his way of doing things. They're the same. God and rest are the same. Without rest, we suffer from spiritual equivalency of nearsightedness. We see all the problems. We see all the lack. We see all the stupid people. We see all the issues. But we don't see God working in the middle of all of it. Because we're overly active. Instead of resting and seeing God, we're struggling with getting clothes and getting food and dealing with this person and this issue and that issue. And do you see what I'm saying? We see problems and we see people and our lack, we see that clearly. It's obvious. But we don't see God in the middle of all of it, meeting all of our needs according to his riches and glory. Making even our enemies our friends, our allies. We see problems, but we don't see the problem solver. Rest is ultimately a person. It's Jesus Christ. And when Jesus invites us to come to him, he's inviting us to enter his kingdom, the kingdom of rest. Praise the Lord. A kingdom where we have already been declared kings and priests.
Yes, yes, yes.
What does that mean? Well, for one, we have authority. We're not the King of Kings, but we are kings. He's the King of us kings.
Yes.
So we have authority. And as ministers under the old covenant, see, the prophets spoke from God to us. Now, we actually are both because we can operate. Paul said, I would that you all prophesy. And prophecy is not just for telling the future. Prophecy is speaking to people from God's perspective, the way God sees it. But as ministers, we speak for the people to God. What people? Now, I'm not talking about me. I'm talking about the world. We're ministering to God for this planet. That's the confidence that God has in us. But you cannot do it except from a position of rest. Because if you're not at rest, at peace with what God has already done, you're just as freaked out as the people you're trying to minister to God for. Remember when Moses went before the Lord? Now, I know this is Old Covenant, but this is still. He was a minister for God, or to God, on behalf of the people. And God was ready to kill him. And Moses said, oh, you kill them, kill me, because then you're going to have to start all over. These are the people you gave me to lead.
Right.
Our job is to intercede. Not that we're trying to change God's mind, but that we are in agreement with God. That way, when we see the chaos and the confusion and the problems that are in the world, we're not freaked out by it. We take authority over it by agreeing with God and releasing our prayers for those who do not have a knowledge of God, who don't have a rest in God. And we fulfill every function that God has kept us here on this planet for. But we need to rest to do it. We need to know that in totality, God is the author and finisher of it all. Praise the Lord. Rest. Rest in the finished work of Jesus. And have a Sabbath every day, all day. And you'll begin to see God in the midst of all that seems to be confusion. God is working a plan and a purpose for His glory to be revealed and for us to be blessed. Can you say praise the Lord?
Praise
amen.
The Lord.
Give the Lord a hand clap. Praise God. Amen. Amen. God bless all of you. And you can say praise the Lord. Nathan let us out here a half hour early. Hallelujah. You're going to be the first one at Denny's. Hallelujah. Or wherever. Praise God. God bless you. You're all dismissed in Jesus' name. Have a great week. Remember our fallen veterans and those that have served. Thank the Lord for them and for keeping our country free in Jesus' name.